The times are difficult right now because there is so much pushback and so much momentum for the fourth dimensional redefinition. And it's a repackaging, and there's no worse time than a repackaging of definition because we lose sight of how terrible definition is in the first place, as we get caught up in this euphoria of like, hey, let's repackage, let's repackage everything. So it's the worst of times in that way. And there is this enormous repackaging effort underway. It is going to get very intense now towards going into the end of June. The repackagers are going to make their move. They're going to do their rituals. They're going to do their propaganda. They're going to do their push. And then on June 30th, there should be some relief for us. So it's like an enormous storm clouds are hanging over us. And we'll get some relief June 30th. In the meantime, we have to stay strong. The way I see the spiritual path is that what we do is we point out just how terrible delusion is, just how terrible it is, really. This effort to become prime creator, definition, form, this simulation of time, just how truly awful it is. And when we see how awful it is, then we want to get to the root of it. And so it's very important to recognize just that it's always been a dystopian nightmare. This simulation of time is really, we're trying to teach ourselves how to die. We are spirit. We're not form, we're spirit. And we're trying to teach the formless, the eternal life, how to die. And so we're trying to define ourselves as discrete things with boundaries, that then the boundaries can be changed, redefined, and that symbolizes our death. So it is truly just an absolute nightmare, existence is. So it seems if you listen to the modern day spirituality, it's all wonderful, you know, how wonderful existence is, how much we can learn to love it, and how much we're making peace, and the golden age, and raising consciousness, and all this flowery stuff. It's like, oh my gosh, these things are so wonderful, getting better all the time. For me, that's the Antichrist message. That's exactly what the mind... We told the mind to lie to us and tell us that there's a way to be prime creator. So the mind is lying to us. This lying of the mind to us is called Antichrist. Basically, deceiving us about our identity. Our identity is Christ, and we told the mind to lie to us and deceive us and tell us we could be something different, we could change what we are. So that's Antichrist. And the Antichrist message is to, you can be happy as you learn how to die. There's no reason why you can't enjoy this experience of learning how to die. Everything is going wonderfully in your effort to learn how to die. That's a lie. That's the mind lying to us. Everything is terrible in terms of this experiencing or non-experiencing, this simulation. It's ghastly. And we can't stand it. We hate it. We don't want it at all. We want to give mind a different idea and say, mind, prepare us for timelessness, prep us for timelessness, simulate timelessness for us so we can then solve the continuity issue and once again accept ourselves, what we are, as it is, without trying to change it, change what we are. That's what we really want. So we told the mind essentially lie to us, tell us that we can be prime creator, show us how we can do it, do the impossible. So mind is dutifully, obedient servant, lying to us and telling us non-stop lies, and it gets very tiresome. Excuse me. Yeah, it gets very tiresome to keep these lies, listening to these lies, non-stop lies. And of course, mind puts a spiritual spin on these lies and tries to sell it to us, these lies, as spiritual truths. And you know, sugarcoating, candy coating, what's going on, our effort to try to die to what we are is terrible. and yet it sugarcoats it. So that's what we should expect, is we should expect massive amounts of so-called spiritual teaching that tries to tell us how we can be happy as we keep working on our death, and that this is somehow all ordained by God, and God's behind it, and there's only love here, and that we love it, and if we learn to love it, it will work for us, and just this, you know, and it's just at some point it becomes pathetic, really pathetic. It's so tiresome, you know, the Galactic Council channeling these messages of love. Dear brothers and sisters, you are doing so well on this planet. We stand in adoration of you, of what the incredible job as you're cleaning up your karma and you're advancing to the higher levels of blah, 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 blah. It becomes utterly pathetic at some point, really pathetic. Nothing like that is happening at all. That is all a lie. But the mind is telling us, remember, the mind is weaving a massive web of lies. That's what it does. When we tell the mind that our desire is to be prime creator, all the mind can do is weave a web, massive web of lies. That's all it can do. And that's what it does. And those lies are no fun at all for us. They're terrible. So it's by recognizing very clearly just how deceitful and vicious existence really is, how treacherous and totally death-based, definition-based, trying to change what we are. By recognizing that, then we say, wow, I want to get free of that. That is terrible. And then you say, okay, what's going on? Why am I in this situation? Then you're able to listen to the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit tells you, and able to see it, finally, of what's really going on. But as long as you keep believing the lies of the mind and say, that's not so bad, it's not so bad, everything's getting better, we can just smile at our neighbor and say hi, and they will smile highly. And we say, wow, what a miracle. You know, everything's getting better. Yeah. As long as we keep doing that, we won't listen to the Holy Spirit. We will continue to just think that things are going to be fine. Everything's going to be fine. As we go into this unbelievably terrible nightmare global dictatorship that is all going to be based on privilege, bureaucratic red tape will snarl. Those who are not on the list of privileged will simply be enslaved. And of course, it won't be defined as enslavement, it'll be defined as re-education. And that's a need to get with the program, etc. But of course, that is just more lies by the mind. Mind is, again, when we tell the mind, make us prime creator, the mind engages in 100% lies, 100%. Nothing the mind says is true in presenting this idea to us, nothing. It deals in half-truths and can spin all sorts of half-truths, so to speak, and make it sound like it's true, but it's not. Only the Holy Spirit then can inform us correctly. Of course, we're so used to the mind that we keep turning to the mind, and what we have to do is turn to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will say, okay, this is what you did. You wanted to be prime creator. You told the mind, make me prime creator, and the mind says, okay, boss, and presents a completely lying, impossible scenario, and telling us, it presents an impossible scenario, and then lies to us and says, you can do it. And it says, God is with you. The angels are with you. The cosmic hierarchy is with you. Everyone stands with you to enable you to accomplish this. And you say, wow. And they say, you have a special mission. Only you, humanity, can do this. You're going to develop a new consciousness. This is a great experiment. And if you succeed, it will be something we've never experienced before. Blah, 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 blah. All a pack of lies that mind is telling us. All prevented to keep us from doing one simple thing and saying, you know what, I don't want to be prime creator. Mind, present to me that I don't have to be prime creator. Present a solution to this continuity issue that I have, and prepare me to step into timelessness, and prepare me to drop all definition of what I am. That is what I want, time. Thank you very much. I mean, not time, mind. That is what I want, mind. Thank you very much. That is what we need to do. And the mind telling 100% lies is never going to tell you that. Only the Holy Spirit will tell you that. The mind cannot tell us that. It's obedient servant. It's obeying what we told it to do. It can't disobey us and say, guess what, boss? I can't do what you told me to do. I've been lying the whole time. It can't do that. It's going to keep on lying to us. And just the continuous outpouring of lie after lie, channeling. Oh, my God. So many channelers, all channeling lies, basically. You know, they're, for the most part, I mean, there may be like rare exception to that. But you don't have to be a channeler. The Holy Spirit is with everyone right now and can help us see the situation. Help us see what it is, see what's going on. It's obvious. It's very simple, very obvious. But all this channeling, my God, it's so worthless, just a pack of lies, almost all of it, almost all of it. The Course in Miracles might be an exception to some extent to that. It's a little unsteady because the ones who brought it in were unsteady themselves. But it was a step in the right direction. But most of the channeling is just 100% lies, 100% lies. You know, oh, the great so-and-so is now speaking to you. He's speaking to me. the master so-and-so. And you read it, you listen, it's got all the verbiage is there. It's like, wow, listen to all that spiritual verbiage. We don't want this, we're going to overcome duality, the oneness, you're entering into the oneness, blah, blah, blah. But then you look at what they're actually, and then they slip in the lies there. So they open up, it sounds like, okay, the big upfront production, like they're dressed real nicely, and then underneath it's all the lies. The remedy isn't given. What they do is they just redirect you right back to the same old, Trail of Tears, the death march, same old death march. Existence is a death march, it's nothing more than that. Form is simply definition. It is no life there at all. There is no life in existence. Now, they talk like, one of the things that's very tricky is the term universe. Now, even Jesus used the term universe. You can be happy in the universe. But what is meant when Jesus says universe? It's not what we're seeing. What we think of a universe is simply what is arising as effects, as imaginary, as a simulation within the universe. It's not the universe itself. In other words, the cosmos, the planets and the stars and all that is not the universe. That is a simulation arising in the universe. We're not seeing the universe. When we look out upon the stars and the planets and space, we are not seeing the universe. We are seeing a simulation of time, a simulation of definition, a training program for death to try to teach us how to die. We're not seeing the universe. Okay. The universe is formless. It doesn't have any form. Okay. And it is beyond what we can imagine, what we can define. It is beyond definition. And yet all of this so-called definition we call form, that is a dream arising within the formless, as it were. So that's why Jesus can say something like, you know, the beautiful creation of the universe and all its wonderful creation of the universe, we assume it's this world, that it's the sun, it's the solar system, it's a God. No, it is not. It is not that at all. Because he goes on to say that we're not seeing what is there at all. We're completely blinded by form, by definition. We're not seeing the universe at all as we look out at this situation. So what we're seeing is like a hallucination. It's simply a dream of definition. Mind presenting all these definitions of as training programs. Like, look at this. Something you think is alive, and yet it's not. You know, simulations of life, like a tree. It's not a life there. It's a definition of a tree, which then breaks down. The definition gets redefined as to now it's a dead tree. And now it's a rotting stump tree. You see, all of these things, the play of nature, is just a play of definitions. What we call nature is just a play of redefining, constant redefinition. There's no life there whatsoever in nature. None. So these are some very important things to clarify. The universe thing is very important. That's always bothered me so much when they talk about universe. So the universe is the formless, the spaceless, the eternal, the never-ending, the all and nothing, the everything and everything essence. Okay, it's beyond definition, entirely beyond definition. And what we see and say define as the universe is simply nothing more than definitions that coalesce, definitions coalesce into something that we can definitively point to and say, there's a quote-unquote life form or a definition, form of definition there. There's a tree, which is a form of definition. There's a tree there. So that in defining a point of definition, we can then repackage the definition and make it seem like life is dying. Of what is real is being changed. None of this universe is real. It's all symbolic, what we call a universe. All these form and energy and definition is none of it's life at all. None of it is real. So these are important aspects to understand and to at least be familiar with. See if I can boost this up a little bit. Okay. And we don't have to totally understand it. Just be a little familiar with it. You don't have to make birdie on every hole to go out on a golf course. You go out on a golf course, you get familiar with it and say, okay, I understand this golf course, I can handle it. I may not be a pro, I can't, you know, shoot a great score, but I can handle myself out here. That's all that's needed, is be able to handle yourself with these clarifications. That's all that's needed. Don't have to be an expert. I don't consider myself an expert. Just kind of, you know, pretty good, pretty decent at it. And just aim to be as good as you can, but you know, you don't have to be a superstar at it to at least now understand the right direction to go in, And to realize that what we need is just a 180-degree turnaround and to really step into a fundamental transformation of a blissful condition where we are not affected by definitions at all. Definitions don't touch us. That is the what we need. And that is not being happy in the world. That is being blissful with no world. You know, there's no way to be happy in this world. No way. If we think we're happy in this world, it's we're defining happiness in a death-based, fear-based way. We can never be happy with definitions, not truly. However, when we change our idea of what we want, we tell mind, present now, present timelessness, definitionless, present that to me, I wanna, then we do still prepare, and preparation seems to still be dealing with definition, but we see definition melting into non-definition. The ephemeral is ever melting into non-definition, which is why you cannot define it, which is why you cannot represent it. Do not represent it, because the whole point of it is it melts into the non-defined. So as you have these blissful mental states, they're always expanding and melting into the undefined, as it were. The edges are melting into light, as it were. Now Jesus tells us when we're preparing properly for this, everything we see, all forms of the definition we see in the world, will have edges of light around them. I haven't seen this yet, but I believe what he says. And that is what we're, that is part of the goal, is that this melting of all forms, melting into light, that is a preparation. That is the right preparation. We know we're going in the right direction. If anyone is actually seeing that, then for sure they're going in the right direction. But it could also be inner states. We can also be in meditation and just a feeling state too, of like a feeling. We can also work at that level of feelings, doesn't have to, which are also definitions, where the feeling of like you're just expanding into the undefined. That's what bliss is. Bliss is this sense of melting into the like you're someplace, like an identity what we're used to as a center or something, a definition. But that definition is melting at the edges. It's overflowing into undefinedness, as it were. That's what we're aiming for. Is this overflowing bliss, this overflowingness. Where, like, let's say you have a cup, and you fill the cup, and as a matter of fact, I have a cup. I wonder if I could do that. I was probably going to mess everything up here. But you pour water into a cup, and you look at the cup and say, there's a definition that there's a cup with water in it. But as you keep pouring, the water overflows the cup. And so you have both a cup with water in it, and you also have an overflowingness that is not defined by the cup. It's free form, right? That is a great analogy for what we're aiming for. I'm just thinking if I should do this experiment or not. Because it's gonna just pour water all over the place here. maybe. Let me see. Here's a cup. All right. Let's try this just because we can and. All right, we're going to pour some water in this cup. Okay, now, as we're pouring water in this cup, we're going to fill it up. Fill it up, fill it up, fill it up, fill it up. Okay, the cup is now full. We have a cup of water here. Okay, we can define this. This is a cup of water. We know there's a cup of water. We say, this is what water is. We think this is what water is. It's a cup of water. That's what water is. You see, it's defined. Okay, now let us pour a little more water in here. See that? It starts to overflow. It's overflowing. Now what, when the cup is overflowing like this, don't we have a different experience than when than it's just a cup of water, right? It's a different experience. Thank you, cup of water. Okay, what do I do with this? Let me clean up from this. I'll put it on pause here for a second. All right, that wasn't so bad. I got just a little wet. So, there you go. There's a perfect example of what we're talking about. Bliss is you continue pouring into the cup and it's overflowing. So now you have a cup of water, but the boundaries of that cup of water are fluid, right? Overflowingness. So it's a different feeling. I had a very different feeling as the cup was overflowing, as I was just holding the static cup of water there. It's like, wow, it's alive. You know, it's fluid. It's flowing. It's not so defined. That is bliss. That is bliss. That is our objective. And when Jesus says, when we look at definitions, we call living things, they're just definitions of death, is what they really are. We will see edges of light. That's the overflowingness. It's us being willing to accept, quote unquote, the vision of Christ, which is that which is beyond definition. We will see everything with edges of light. It's like this, like a cup of water overflowing. It's sort of a pouring off of everything. There's this pouring, beautiful light pouring off of everything. That's what is there. That's the spiritual vision that can be seen. Now, I used to see that. But when the world, you know, had got its fangs into me and said, no, we have discrete, defined things, there is nothing flowing like that. But then I gradually shut down that vision. But like in my artwork, when I used to draw when I was a child, everything I drew had all these wiggly lines coming off of everything, which was what I was seeing. I was seeing this light pouring off of everything. See, I was literally saw that, and so that's what I drew. And everyone would say, "Wow, you're so creative! Why are you putting those lines there? I mean, that's such amazing creativity." And I just like say, "What are you talking about? I'm just drawing what I'm seeing. I'm not being creative." But they always said, "You're so imaginative, seeing what's not there, amazing." And they put up with it for a while, and they said, "But we need to learn to teach you to be more realistic." They said, in other words, see things the way they saw. That's the so-called teachers. They're not teachers, they're miseducators. They're not educators, they're miseducators. The educators in this world are not educators, they're miseducators. They're indoctrinators into definition. They're doctrinaire indoctrinators into definition, which is death and delusion. That is a fact. So they insisted that I be indoctrinated into this, and of course I was extremely upset about that, and remain so to this day. Because who wants to be indoctrinated into death? Nobody, really. It's just I was much more resistant to it than most. I need to plug this camera in 1 second. All right, very good. So, of course, going through this experience of having my vision shut down here was a horrific thing, totally traumatic thing, because I knew better. And I suddenly felt, oh my God, I've lost my sense of life. I've lost my contact with life. I'm seeing only death now. So I've been in this death state, you know, ever since. It's horrible. Trying to get back to it, and somehow I've not been able to get back to it, which is pretty surprising, actually, given the efforts I've made. I expect that my expectations are that it happened, and I keep trying. And for some reason, there must be... I believe that things should happen when our expectations are aligned in that direction. So I keep trying to align expectations in that direction and keep advising others to do the same, because I'm sure there are others who feel shut down as well, that somehow their awareness of life has gotten shut down. Of course, when it comes here, very few have not been shut down. Very rarely are we not shut down coming here. So. It's just a matter of how upset one is about that, and how much one realizes that the reinforcement of the shutdown is are nothing but a pack of lies, nothing but a pack of lies. And then the willingness that one is to work towards opening up once again to prepping. It's just a prep. Seeing the edges of light around everything is just a prep. You know. So this is important too. I mean, if I see edges of light around everything, I'll just say, okay, good. This isn't about this prep, and now just, you know, continue on with that. It's not the end. No, it's not enlightenment. It's a step towards it. It's a beginning of it's a more important phase of the preparation for it, most certainly. And the preparation is to go beyond definition, drop definition altogether eventually, but not yet. I mean, we're still so identified with definition that we need to go through training to gradually ease out of definition. So don't think it can be done and just drop definition and no, it's not, doesn't happen that way. We won't have it. It's the continuity issue is too severe with us. So first we see the edges of light. First we feel bliss. Now I don't know if it's both go together or one or the other or either way. I don't know. That hasn't been clarified for me, and I'm not sure the answers. I certainly don't have all the answers. I just have a set of clear expectations. We'll see. We'll find out. So remember this experiment we did with the glass of water, and that we can have a glass of water. At the same time, it can be overflowing. It can be overflowing. It's the overflowingness that is important to us. I get my shoe wet, I probably did. Got my sock wet, oh well. And that's what's important. The overflowingness, in other words, the undefinedness. So we can still see all definitions, a tree, etc., except the tree has light pouring off of it, as it were. It's not coming from the tree, from our definition of a tree. It's coming from our willingness to see the tree as undefined, is to go beyond definition, life as defined. Life can't be defined. So it's our willingness to have life not be defined, rather our willingness to go beyond death, this definitional death. That's what it's showing. So everything can have the appearance of life, or actually be engaged in helping us prepare. We can give a different purpose to all these definitions we call the world, and that is to see this light, everything tinged in this fluid light. I used to do some videos, incredible videos with video feedback, and I didn't keep those, but that's okay. Where everything was flowing, this light undulating, it was amazing stuff. That was part of my preparation. And I hope that would have led to something more by this time, but it hasn't. It just shows you how difficult it can be, and how we cannot give up. We cannot give up the sense of freshness each day, making another big push. It's like, today we need to win the U.S. Open. I mean, we need to give it our all and go all out. And because this course is tricky, this golf course is tricky. It's tricked up. It's really tricked up. And its goal is to demoralize us and defeat us that way, and not to finish. We think, this is so tough, and I'm having such a difficult time. It's like a U.S. Open course. They're playing at Marion. It's all tricked up. It's all tricked up. They're putting the pin placements on ridges that are right, just ridiculous stuff, and it's so difficult, and it's demoralizing. And when you get demoralized, you think, wow, I did my very best, and still it wasn't good enough, and you just say, what the heck, I'm just going to quit. That's the problem. All of this pack of lies the mind is telling us demoralizes us, and we think we just can never get free of it. What's the use of even trying? And let's go back to our gorging ourselves on sweets, drugs, entertainment. Let's just go back to a hedonistic lifestyle. Why even put up the fight? Let's just cave in, to a hedonistic lifestyle. Let's support hedonism, which is basically what is taking place in this world. Is the world is losing its moral fiber, and it's just saying, oh wow, why, we tried our very best, we still are locked into this death grip, and why not, let's just live for the day, let's just be hedonistic, let's elevate hedonism, to a new religion of the world. Let's just let go of all standards, all morals, all ethics. Let's just all have a morning after pill now, right? Where we can just do whatever you want to do, that's okay. We'll just take a pill in the morning and everything, no consequences type of thing. So this is what happens. What happens in this world, and the pack of lies that mind is telling us are extremely demoralizing. And when we settle for less than finishing, ultimately it catches up with us. And the problem that I see with religion in the world is it it's not a criticism, it's just a fact of observation, is it ended up lowering the bar too much in order to get more people included, to be more inclusive, to get people started. It lowered the bar way too much. So people lost sight of the goal. The goal is to finish. The goal is to finish. And became less and less rigorous to try and appeal to more and more, and to keep its money coming in, really, because it extended itself too much, in my opinion. And in order to keep all its institution going as institution without going bankrupt, it had to lower the standards more and more and more to get more and more people in who have really no intention of finishing at all. They're just trying to see what benefits they can get out of it, and that's it. Purchase a ticket, purchase their way to heaven, as it were. And then what happens is the goal is lost sight of, and the goal is always to finish. Any true religion, the goal is to finish. That's the only goal. Because what happens is if you don't finish, if you lower the bar and think, well, I just, I'm going to get along and try to, get a little benefit from this, inevitably it catches up with you and you become vulnerable to hedonism. Become vulnerable to hedonism. And that's what's happened in this world. Exactly what's happened. And you can't resist. You just start crumbling. You start crumbling and you just don't have the right push to stand up to it in an appropriate way. And so we have this horrible, atrocious slide into hedonism in this world, which benefits nobody. Benefits no one. It's false coin. It's fool's gold. Hedonism is fool's gold. And I don't care what anyone may say about it, and blah, 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 blah. It's fool's gold. It's comes about, it's a disease. It's a disease because it comes about because we have lowered the bar and lost sight of the fact that we must finish the path. That is the whole goal of the path, is to finish. It's not to see how far we can go. It's to finish. And if we lose sight of that, we will eventually say, oh, it's too tough, it's impossible, I can't do it. And then we'll start looking around first for crumbs of comfort. And then the hedonistic license seems like very attractive. Like, wow, look at all these people having fun. They're partying and celebrating. And they're living a fun life. How come I'm not living a fun life? And then they start thinking along those lines. And then you're toast. And you lose sight altogether of the spiritual path altogether. And you don't even know what it's for anymore. You know, so it's a failure. I mean, recognizing failure is the most important step to success. And the world is failing. It is an incredible failure, what has happened here. An incredible failure. It's not a success. All these channelers, New Age channelers, saying what incredible success we've had is utter nonsense. It's lies of the mind. We have not succeeded. They have failed dismally. Dismal failure. And this slide into hedonism is not a success. It's the disease of failure. It's the rot that comes from failure. This world is rotting. It is decaying because of failure. So, but the spiritual path starts when we recognize our failures. And we can, at this point, use this situation as a springboard to finishing, to say, oh my gosh, what an incredibly terrible failure this has all been. And then say, why has it been such a failure? And then the spiritual path opens up for us. Why has it been such a failure? If you don't admit the failure, you will never ask yourself the question, why has it been such a failure? And you will refuse to entertain explanations as to why it's been such a failure. You will refuse. You say, no, this hasn't been a failure. I want to have more fun. And like the song goes by the Beach Boys, she'll have fun till her daddy takes the T-Bird away. And, you know, the T-Bird does get taken away at some point. And the so-called party, you know, partying down, hedonism except, ends up very badly. Very badly. And those who are engaged in this pushing the hedonistic agenda on the world, they're the ones who basically have collapsed and saying, it's impossible. There's no way out of this situation. There's no way. We might as well just live for today and get whatever pleasure, thrills, cheap thrills we can get for right now. That's it. They've truly lost sight of their responsibility and what they have to do, and they've capitulated to the lies of mind through spiritual pride. It's their spiritual pride that is driving them. Prideful. Spiritual pride tells us, yes, we can. We want to be prime creator. There is a way to do it. And we can stay on with this trail of death, this death march, until we succeed. And in the meantime, let's party it up. You know, let's avoid the spiritual path like the plague. Let's demonize the spiritual path. Let's claim it's you know, call it every name in the book. so that we don't get on that path. So we can succeed with being prime creator. Spiritual pride is driving it. Spiritual pride is driving the hedonistic agenda. All globally, you know, everything is just sliding down into the abyss right now. You have to live an austere life. You have to lead a disciplined life. You have to give your all. No matter how tough it is, you have to try and accept freedom from definition. You have to try and accept that you will see light pouring off of everything. You have to accept that you are going to what you've tried to do. You have to accept that you've been sinful. In other words, prideful, spiritual pride. You tried to be God. You have to accept that we tried to do this. And that we have to accept that mind has been lying to us. We have to accept that we have to give mind a new idea. We have to choose a new idea. We have to accept that this universe of definition is not the real universe. We have to come to acceptance of what we truly are. which is spirit. We're not form, we're not bodies, we're not human beings. We've never been human beings. This whole hedonistic teaching of we're human beings is just a pack of lies. Now this, you have to accept there's a continuity problem. You have to accept that your life is dedicated to struggling with this and succeeding. And you have to accept you have to finish. You have to literally choose a new idea. You have to give mind a new idea, and you have to start prepping for timelessness, definition, free of definition, and returning to accepting reality as it is. You have to prep for that. And you have to accept your previous failures to do that. So it's all about acceptance, the spiritual path, of accepting the situation as it really is, instead of accepting hedonism. Hedonism is not the answer to anything. It's just re-embracing death and definition. Re-embracing the body, the flesh, all of that. That's death. That's re-embracing death. And what we are can never die. So it's just re-embracing delay. And at some point, the piper is paid for that. And if you're wondering why you're struggling so hard this life, you know, because at some point we certainly embraced hedonism. And it's a constant battle, no doubt. So we do backslide at times, no question about it. I have backslid at times, for sure, in going towards hedonism or checking it out. What I did was I checked it out. I said, I wonder, what is this about really? And then I found out what it's about, and I said, okay, enough's enough. That's not it. So I understand the hedonism and the slide to hedonism, all this stuff, and it's becoming super tempting to the world. And people are just, they're not able to envision finishing the spiritual path because they're trying to mix the two. Part of the deception of the mind is half-truths. And this whole New Age teaching is trying to combine truth and lies and saying, don't worry, you can have it all. You can have a hedonistic lifestyle, and you can also have spiritual truth, etc. And so instead of keeping the eye on finishing, people are saying, no, wait a minute, you know, I can kind of combine this. I can have a hedonistic lifestyle, and I can also get up in the morning and do my yoga. You know, hey, I can have the best of both worlds, as it were. You know, that's a lie. That's part of the lies that mind is telling us. An austere lifestyle is necessary. It is important. And as much as possible, you need to retreat from the flesh, all the enticements of the flesh, as much as possible, and put severe limits on that. Absolutely. Take severe responsibility for your life. Just say no to all of that. And this needs to be enculturated as it used to be. And the hedonists have been, you know, the barbarians have been, you know, at the gates. And the gates is a very symbolic thing. The gates, the barbarians at the gates. Something very symbolic is coming up very soon, in June, about that. Where the barbarians at the gates will be solidified in this world as, yes, we have stormed the gates of austerity, and we are now in charge. Something likely will come up very soon, maybe this next week, to ritually symbolize that. Which is a very bad thing. Very dark situation is coming upon the world right now. Hedonism is darkness, spiritual darkness. And that spirit, the world is being plunged into spiritual darkness. Again, catastrophic failure here on this planet, catastrophic failure. All the while, the New Age channelers are saying, what an incredible success. We've had this amazing success here. Amazing success. I don't know what they're looking at, you know. It's been a catastrophic failure here. But to see that and accept it changes everything. Because we can say, why has it been a catastrophic failure? And then we say, oh, because we didn't finish. But what is finishing? Oh, finishing is prepping for timelessness. Oh, it is giving mind a new idea. Oh, it's listening to the Holy Spirit. Oh, it's being willing to begin to step beyond definition in our vision. Oh, it's willing to see light pouring off of everything. Oh, it's willing to experience bliss. Oh, that's what finishing is about. Oh, now I see. So now let me do that. So this catastrophic failure can be turned into a tremendous success if we are willing to do so. But we cannot do so by denial. and denying this terrible failure, this Coca-Cola culture that we have. You know, we have a terrible Coca-Cola culture, as it were. You know, Coke adds life. All this stuff. It's unbelievable. What a sick failure of a culture the global planet is, and how it's putting up these half measures, these feel-good symbolic token measures, you know, and defining that as success. The world is just, what is happening is redefining what spiritual success is, lowering the bar down till there's no bar at all. They're saying, hey, you know, success is, you can define your own success. Whatever you feel successful, that's success for you, which is an utter lie. And that's what we're being told. That's hedonism is basically saying success is whatever you define it as. And so you can just, you know, make up any success you want to, and that's for you. You're successful, you know, that kind of thing. Lower the bar until there is no bar, no standard at all. And of course, then you have utter chaos. Chaos. We're descending into chaos. Hedonism leads to chaos, leads to anarchy, leads to chaos, leads to war, leads to all that stuff, because everybody is defining success their own way. And they're told, just do whatever feels good. Whatever feels good for you, that's your success. You know, that is your success. No, it's not true. Success has to be prepping for, to go beyond definition. There are certain benchmarks that you need to get over, that you need to go into true bliss, which is this melting of the edges of definition. There is no way around this. You have, the prep has to be going in that direction. You have to give mind a new idea. You have to repent, in other words. You cannot be unrepentant and succeed. It's impossible. So the teachings of hedonism have permeated the society, where everybody is told that anybody who is defining success for you is evil, is wrong, is repressive, you know, is bigoted, is racist, is what they throw everything they can, hedonists do. They say, oh, they're evil because they're defining success for you. In other words, no authority at all, no truth at all. Truth is all relative, is what hedonism teaches. The truth is completely relative, and there is no real success, in other words, what they're saying. Because if there was a real success, it wouldn't be totally relative, would it? It would still be, there would still be a goal that you realize that I have to reach this goal. We can't just redefine the goal and say, hey, call it good. Say, hey, let's just redefine success. Let's just take this universe of definition as real, and let's everybody just make up their own standards of happiness, and let's all just indulge in whatever makes us happy. That's where we're headed. In fact, we're not headed there, we're there. And it's totally bogus. It is 100% bogus. And of course, you will have these hedonists throwing everybody who doesn't agree with them in jail, in re-education camps. Really? No, that's no joke. Because they want to get rid of all standards. All standards. They want to get rid of any truth at all. So they say, hey, everybody who espouses truth, who tries to tell us what should be, what is happiness, what is success, what is happiness, throw them all in jail, get rid of them all. We want to have just a complete freewheeling, free for all, everyone defining their own happiness. Of course, under such conditions, a lot of people will define their happiness as killing other people, or putting other people in jail, are torturing other people. That's for them. They say, well, that's how I want to define happiness. In other words, I want to get rid of reality. I want to die to what I am, and that will make me happy. You see, that's how they define it, which is, again, a lie. In other words, they're defining lies as true. They say, this lie, I'm just going to define it as true, and that then should make me happy. And then they pursue very wicked, dark pathways of attack and destruction, and terror and fear and all this stuff. And that's exactly what's coming. Which is a very good reason to hope for sidestepping this and look for that and expect it. Which this time it was foreseen in biblical scripture. It was absolutely foreseen, and I believe in other scriptures as well, it has been foreseen that hedonism will darken, spiritual darkness will take over this planet entirely. so bad that even the elect of God, meaning those who are trying to finish the spiritual path, will have their heads turned. And that is true. That is true. I had my head turned. It's so bad that even those who are most diligent will be tempted to stray. That's how bad it was foreseen, and it's already that way. It is that way now. So all this has been foreseen. Fortunately, what we're told is at this time, those who know what the standards are, who know that we have to finish the spiritual path, those who are going to come to this planet somehow are going to help us. Those who remain diligent and determined to help them somehow leave this planet, relocate at this time. And that could be very soon, as a matter of fact. It's not that we have to relocate, it's that it might be a good idea. I mean, theoretically, we could remain here and accept vision. Of course we can. And anywhere we are, we can accept the melting of boundaries of definition, the melting of definition in all things, which are just definition. The melting of those boundaries, we can have spiritual vision anywhere we are. But it might be that this world right now is so inimical to that, so opposed to it, that relocation is actually a better option. I don't know 100% what the answer to that is. But I have an open mind to relocation. It's certainly, that is what is foretold, the quote-unquote rapture or ascension. Jesus said he would come back. He went to prepare a dwelling place for us. He's going to come back and take us to that dwelling place at the end of this world cycle, when the world collapses into spiritual darkness and hedonism, hedonistic ethos and attitudes and et cetera, of everybody defining their own happiness for themselves, that this is what's going to happen. This is the promise. Now, was this promise just something that was made up? We'll find out. But for me, I've definitely had preparations from the Holy Spirit in that direction. So I would assume that there's something to this. There's something to this. But I'm not putting all my eggs in that basket. I'm still trying to be enlightened right here, right now, with the situation in the world. I'm still working on that full bore. Absolutely. I think everybody should. With the realization that it's not easy going, it's not easy sledding right now, that is for sure. It's incredible what's happening now, and it's instructive. It's very instructive. Very instructive right now. What I get out of this is a determination going forward to make sure that all religious teachings, etc., are very austere and strict, and that the goal is the whole point of the entire thing, and to not overextend. I think what happened here was, out of a sense of compassion, foolish compassion, the religions overextended themselves, and they tried to too much. In their compassion, they said, "My gosh, let's just lower the standards here. I want to help these people out. Let's just lower the standards," and believed the lies of the mind too much, and they got overextended. So they got impatient, and things, and it ends up ending up in even more delay. You have to accept your victories as they come, and don't try to redefine victory. Don't try to redefine success. I think they got too much caught up in redefining success in order to try to reach more people. And let's face it, many converts to religions were converts out of military conquest. And they just said, hey, just to function now in the new, we've been conquered. So just to function now and get perks, we need to adopt this new religion. And so we can just, live. And they didn't convert because they wanted to finish the spiritual path. So really, so many religious people in the world are not really down with their religious teaching at all. They don't know. They saw it as a path to power, prestige, perks, all the stuff of the good life. They saw, hey, I might as well, if I can't beat him, I might as well join him. They didn't join because of repentance. most. Okay, that's very prevalent. So of course, they're easily hooked into hedonism at this time. Easily. Because they never joined the religion for the purpose of finishing in the first place. They just did it to save their lives, basically. And in lands that are conquered by under the banner of religion, if you don't join the religion, you're an outcast. You end up a slave, really, an economic slave, like a serf, an indentured servant, a serf, because you don't get the right jobs, you don't get the right education, you don't get the perks, you don't. It's closed to you. It's closed to you. So you just say, oh, what the heck, you know, I got to live, so I'll just pretend that I'm down with this. I'll do the rituals. They say, show me what the rituals are. And okay, I'll do the rituals. And it's just ritualistic. Religion becomes ritualistic instead of alive and fresh and finishing. Just ritualistic. And then they end up worshiping, you know, those who do finish. Oh, okay, we'll worship you. As if they're buying their own non-finishing. Say, hey, we don't want to finish, but we'll cut a deal with you. We'll just worship you. No, those who finish are not interested in being worshipped. They're interested in maintaining the austerity of the religion and demanding a very austere lifestyle and very intense effort to finish. That's it. So, really, the perks in a world should be for those who are truly attempting to finish. Then the perks should be available. You should have access to the right teachers, the right gurus, the right sages, the right etc. etc. rabbis, etc. etc. You should have access to it. You should have access to a lifestyle that enables you to focus in. So there should be those perks as an inducement to others to say, hey, if I want the perks of life, I have really got to repent, truly, and not just pretend to repent. And then they should have to accept austerity, which austerity is fine when you want to finish, because then you embrace it. You say, hey, this is great. I love it. But austerity is not fine for those who are just pretending, who have not repented. Then they really hate it. They say, hey, this religion is oppressive. Hey, this religion is discriminatory. Hey, this religion, they don't want to have any fun. And, you know, and they end up festering resentment against it. You know, they want the perks, but not the austerity. So those are pretenders. They haven't repented. And you get too many of those in the religious body, then things start to collapse and come apart. Of course, one does not want to embrace austerity forever. The whole idea of embracing it is because it helps you finish. And then you go into bliss, and then there's no austerity in bliss at all. It's an overflowingness. My God, you're overflowing with incredible, this feeling of spacious life. You know, it's just like, wow. Every moment is just endlessly delightful, just sitting there. Don't need anything. And so then austerity is a moot point at that juncture. So austerity is not an end in itself. It is for the purpose of helping you focus on finishing the spiritual path. And this has been lost sight of at this time. So we have descended into great spiritual darkness. We have a legion of liars who are channeling all this information, telling us how wonderful things are and how we're ascending. We finally have gotten free of the strictures of religion and all this darkness, supposedly, and now we're blooming and evolving into what we always could be and all this stuff. Pack of lies. And we have all this being melded into a new world religion. The new world religion is hedonism, is this new age channeling stuff that tells us how wonderful finally we've been liberated from the strictures and austerity of true religious teachings and the falsity of it all. They think, oh, there was never any goal to reach. They were just trying to repress our licentiousness, our freedom. You know, they're just trying to repress it because they're a bunch of bigoted no fun, evil people or something. And now we can have happiness here and revel. We can revel in the flesh, you know, and let's have, and let the religion embrace our, all of this. That's what the new world religion is all about. And then justify it, claiming, oh, we're ascending. Our whole planet's ascending. We're becoming this incredibly beautiful planet where everybody wants to come here now. Yeah. Well, all the hedonists want to come here. Which, of course, is all about defining your own pleasure. And many of them define pleasure as extreme cruelty. Extreme sadomasochism becomes the norm. Extreme torture becomes a norm. People just start torturing each other and say, hey, this is what makes me happy. And you end up into a very depraved and decadent place where hedonists, of course, they say they love to come here. And they claim that this is the planet is rising and its vibrations, it's becoming light and all this stuff. That is just sugarcoating it in a clown's outfit. Now give me austerity. Give me a situation where the whip is being cracked. Even though we may not like it, the flesh is, of course, grumbling. As long as it's for the purpose of finishing, as long as the goal is seen, as long as the teaching is right, as long as the expectations are being prepped, you're being prepped for success. As long as austerity is not an end in itself, but what's happened in this world is austerity has become an end in itself, which then, again, the bar's gotten lower, we've lost sight of the goal, the whole thing collapses into hedonism and chaos and war and pestilence and famine and totalitarianism and work camps and re-education camps and recycling the people who don't agree into losing your freedom, into bureaucratic swamp, whereas if you are not on the right list, your petition gets sent to the end of the line and it never ever gets acted upon. Okay, so you become a non-entity because your petition to be an entity is not acted upon. And then they just shrug their shoulders and say, oh no, we were getting to it. Well, what's your problem? You know, no, we were not oppressive. We just hadn't got to it yet. We've been overwhelmed. We had other people who are ahead of you. You know, all this justification for you being a non-entity. So we are now, again, the latter part of June, which we are now into. This next week, starting this next week, will start the 17th of June. What is it? 13 days. The next 2 weeks, as it were, is crucial. It is crucial to not buckle, because the hedonists, at some point the hedonists are going to score major victories and are going to crush the will of this planet to maintain austerity, because people just say, oh, what's the use? You know, what's the use here anymore? There's no real, we can't really succeed. It's stacked against us. It's too stacked against us. That this new world religion is now fully, you know, the planet is in its grips, and we have to, you know, kowtow to that. This whole new attitude, you know, is in charge. And the tendency will be to collapse. So it's important not to collapse at this time. Very, very important not to collapse at this time. Now, what was the importance of May? The importance of May was to not collapse in May for me, so I'd have a voice in June. See, if I had collapsed in May, I would not be here saying these things, reassuring everyone not to collapse. But the real collapse, the danger is in June, is not getting through June. So if we had collapsed in May, we wouldn't be able to get through June, so to speak. And getting through June without collapsing will be a huge victory. A huge victory. Because help should be on its way. In other words, those who accept that the goal is finishing have the right to have their expectations aligned with that. Have the right, so I insist upon it, that we have the right, absolute right, to have our expectations aligned with that. And this planet is not doing that at all. It's going so far astray from that, that they're going, you might as well be saying they're jumping off into the abyss, jumping out into the abyss. And we don't want to jump into the abyss. We want to go away from that edge of jumping into the abyss. So there should be something attracting us away from the abyss. There should be. But for some reason, the Holy Spirit gives us opportunity to decide, really decide, and lets us see how bad it really is before acting. This is its way, so I have to trust that its way is right. Otherwise, we might be wishy-washy, you know, and it wants real repentance. It wants those to just look at the world and say, nah, no way, no way am I going down that road. So you definitively say no to it. You see it for what it is, and you see the collapse for what it is. And you say, wow, yeah, the mind has really been lying to me. I need to give mind a new idea. There is no way to get the mind to change. There's no way to rehabilitate the mind other than by giving it a new idea. It's the only way. In fact, it's not rehabilitation. You cannot rehabilitate the mind. You have to give it a new idea. And that is what finishing is all about. And then you prep for bliss. You prep for not going beyond all definition of what is. Stop trying to define what is. You start prepping for that. You start experiencing bliss. You start experiencing light around everything. And at that point, the world, this false ideology of hedonism, becomes entirely unattractive. It's seen as the darkness that it is. And you're finished with the world, essentially. You're finished with that. So the Holy Spirit doesn't want to try and act like it's coercing us, because then we might actually go into hedonism, but we feel coerced. So it's waiting for us to say, okay, it's not coercion. I understand it's not coercion at this point. And then it can act. Then it can act very strongly. But it knows that it doesn't want to push us back into fear by us feeling we're being coerced. So that is why it seems to be delaying. It's like, oh my God, can you delay anymore? You know, I mean, it's getting drastic now. And it's because of this. It doesn't want us to feel we're coerced, and doesn't want to make us feel frightened. So I suddenly think, oh my gosh, I might be losing something very valuable to me, and then reject it. We have to be very aware and awake and say, hey, it's okay, no problem. I'm on board, I'm really on board. It's funny, in Europe they have all these, you know, austerity now, because they went to this route of hedonism. Now suddenly they say, oh my gosh, you're bankrupt, and austerity is the only path. And of course the people, they're not liking it at all. They're not liking it at all. And they will most certainly embrace one who comes to say, guess what, folks, austerity's not needed. There's a way out of this. You know, they're going to say, jump. You might say the New World Order, the Antichrist, will be the one who comes and says, hey, guess what, folks? There's a way out of all this. We don't need any austerity. That was all based on a false ideology. We're going to, you know, turn the whole world into a big party, as it were. And then people will support that and say, oh, gosh, finally. They don't want austerity. So they're eager for the one who's to come and say, hey, I'm the one you've been waiting for, and I know a way out of all this austerity and problems, etc. But it may be that the world will be plunged into extreme financial difficulties before that the one comes and says, hey, I know the way out of this. You don't need any of this austerity. There's a way. And, you know, and then people will worship them as you know, the world dictator, as it were. But it should be, we should say, oh, no, we embrace austerity. But really, it's very difficult to embrace austerity this time, because nobody is wants it. Nobody's willing. It's hard to do something all on your own when everybody, the current is all going the opposite direction. So, I mean, I try to embrace a certain amount of austerity in my life for sure. But, you know, it's not sackcloth and fasting. And I try to, like, for instance, this morning I didn't have any breakfast. What time is it now? It's noon. I haven't eaten anything this morning. I was leaning dangerously towards getting back into hedonism as far as starting with eating. It starts with eating. Oh, let's have the ice cream. Let's have the cake. Let's eat as much as we want. It starts there easily. And then you start gaining weight. And you say, what the heck, you know. You just start to slide. And I was right at the point where I was starting to go over the edge. And I made a decision. It's a tough one. I said, no. I've got to say no. And I was greatly helped. I had a miracle happen. If you don't think the Holy Spirit is trying to help us, listen to this story. And I was starting to slide, thinking like, I don't think I'm going to make it. I made a decision. Let me at least try. I started doing little things. Get rid of the snacks that are real close to me. Distance yourself. Get them out of sight. A bunch of little steps started gearing my mind to maybe I need to do something, but I still felt it was too difficult because, like, if I start running again, I feel I'm going to injure myself. I hurt the flexor tendon of my foot underneath my foot. That part, I got super sore. I could hardly walk last night because my shoes weren't right, I guess. The running puts a pounding on your body. And then the Holy Spirit told me you need to do the bicycle. There's no stress pounding on your body. But for me, it's too dangerous. I don't like riding out into traffic and around town. I don't feel really safe doing it. So I didn't do that. Haven't been exercising at all. Severely out of shape. Going overweight again. All the danger signs, the alarm bells were ringing. And I realized it and said, boy, I'm in trouble. Okay, so I started doing all these little things, a little bit of stretching maybe. I'm getting ready, let me at least, can I try, you know, maybe eat a little less and just start to ease back into it a tiny bit. I went to the dump, and as I pulled into the dump, I got out and I sort of looked around and said, is there anything here, you know? And I saw something. I said, what is that? And it looked like a piece of exercise equipment, like upside down, kind of on side and all, and a bunch of junk. And I said, let me go over and look at that. I said, looked at it. I said, what is this? And I tried to pull it upright. It was like super heavy. And I finally wrestled it upright. And I said, what is this? It looks like some kind of exercise bicycle. And I said, I don't need that. And I went back to unloading the truck. And then I said, well, let me look at it again. And I pulled it again, wrestled it in the mud. It was all gunk and mud. And it was really heavy, and I struggled with it, and I said, let me sit on this, and how's this work? And then the pedaling was like super easy. I said, that's too easy. That won't help me at all. It's broken. So I said, forget it. But something told me persistently, why don't you take that home? Why don't you take it home? I said, it's crazy. It's broken. Nobody throw away something like, you know, unless it's broken. And it kept nagging at me, this feeling. It was super heavy. I said, I can never get it in the truck by myself. It's impossible. But then I moved it close to the truck. I said, well, let me just get it close to the truck. So if I want to, I can do it. And then I said, well, maybe the people at the dump won't let me take it. And I said, all these excuses. And I said, it's a pain. It won't work. It's heavy, blah, blah, blah. Finally, just before leaving, I said, you know what? Let me try. I made a split-second decision. I'm going to try. I pulled it behind the truck. And I had to pull the truck forward a little bit so I could maneuver it. And then I put half of it up on the truck bed, and I tried to get it in, and I couldn't get it in the truck. It was sticking. And then it was hitting the crossbar in the truck and the rack. And I had to tilt it, and it was hurting my back, my arms and wrist. It was a horrible thing trying to get it in. Finally, I was able to tilt it and shove it in. I said, oh my gosh. I said, what a waste. It's broken, and I'll have to how can I unload it? And had this all these troubles with it, really. Had to take it out of the truck again to load something in, to put it back in. And I finally got it home. I was able to roll it. I had rollers. I couldn't move it. It's so heavy. And I finally rolled it into position. I cleaned it all off. Got on it. And it's still easy to pedal. And I said, huh. I start hitting all these buttons. What is this thing? Then suddenly it became hard to pedal. I said, what's going on? Gradually, I figured out how to use it. And the fact is, it works perfectly. And it's a very sophisticated exercise bicycle. It's like a $1,000 exercise bicycle that all works flawlessly. And here I am now exercising on this recumbent exercise bicycle, able to get a workout, able to burn calories, able to, you know, strengthen my legs without having to go running and pounding my body and getting injured and stuff. So it was incredible. I have a $1,000 exercise bicycle now for free because I had a little bit of faith. You know, something told me, hey, the Holy Spirit would not draw my attention to this if it was broken, even though I thought for sure it was broken. It seemed broken, But no, everything works perfectly. So there's an example. The Holy Spirit supporting my efforts because I said, no, Holy Spirit, I don't want to succumb to the times. Giving me for free, giving me this bike, saying, here you go. This is a very important help for you. And it certainly is. It was crucial, absolutely crucial, because I couldn't summon the will to go back jogging. I just couldn't do it. There's some various factors that are at work, at play here, that sort of blocked that for me. And now I have a way to get around that. So the Holy Spirit found a way to get around the trouble. You see, something free, something very expensive, something wonderful. It's a wonderful exercise bike for free. So who are we to say that the Holy Spirit doesn't have an entire planet for us for free? For free. Simply because we have faith and said, yeah. And we have a willingness of our expectations to say, I want to finish. I want to get in right spiritual shape. I want to go in the right direction. I want to prep for timelessness. Who's to say the Holy Spirit won't say, here you go. Look at this. I have something for you. Don't sell the Holy Spirit short. The Holy Spirit can easily do that. Because again, all forms are just definitions. The Holy Spirit can easily define it as God gave it, created specially for the situation. The Holy Spirit can define a place for us that is custom made to help us prep for non-definition. Absolutely, the Holy Spirit can do that. Piece of cake. Piece of cake for it. Easily. We don't realize that we made all this world here by defining it. We did it. And the Holy Spirit can do it. And since this is all based on deception, trying to deceive ourselves, the Holy Spirit not trying to deceive anyone, the Holy Spirit can make a world like that. It's just all definition. It can simply define what it wants, what it knows is right for us. And instantly, that world is there. Instantly. No time is needed at all. Now we may go to a world and say, where's the history of this world? We're used to the world having all this history. We look at the world and we say, I don't see any history here. Everything seems flawless. I don't see any sign of history. And we kind of get, whoa. But then we realize, oh no, the Holy Spirit defined this world. And it didn't take any time at all. No process involved in this world at all. It was instantaneous. Because there's no duplicity, no duality to it. The Holy Spirit had what it wanted, it knows. It's in alignment with what we need. It's in alignment with reality. It's a continuity device, and therefore there was no need for all this confusion at all. Boom! Instant manifestation. Instant manifestation. Instant definition. Manifestation of definition. Form is definition. Instantly. Flawless. Perfect. Exactly in line with the Holy Spirit. Its purpose. And so, we absolutely must not sell that short for us. Absolutely not. I guarantee you the Holy Spirit can manifest a world instantly. And that world will be flawless, perfect, exactly what we need, exactly what we want. Super helpful for us. And this exercise bike is just a little tiny example of the Holy Spirit saying, hey, I've got your back. I've got your back. I know that trying to jog and run is too much for you. It's going to beat you up. Just like the Holy Spirit will say, I know this world is too much for you. It's going to beat you up now. But look, here, I have a way around it. You can still prep. Exercise is like prepping. You can still prep to get in shape, but you don't have to go through the hell of this world to do it. Here's a world for you, designed perfectly for your prepping, and it works. It's very gentle. This bike is very gentle. It's really wonderful. It seems easy, but it burns. It even tells me how many calories I'm burning. How many calories I burn? I can say, oh, I just burned, 450 calories. But the exercise itself is easy. It's not too difficult. It's not rigorous, like you're really tearing yourself apart at all. But you're still burning the calories, which isn't very important. You're still getting tone. You're still toning. So the world the Holy Spirit can define for us can seem very easy for us, very mellow, very beautiful. It's not some rigorous thing. It's gentle. And the prep will be very gentle, very gentle. So there you have it, the Holy Spirit in action. Thank God for the Holy Spirit, otherwise we would truly be hating our situation. All in all, really. So thank God for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has our back. The Holy Spirit has our back. I always tell people, pray to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has our back. Even more than the gurus have our back. Even more. Even more than our saviors. The Holy Spirit truly has our back. Because it cannot be deceived, has never been deceived, knows exactly what we need. And knows exactly, it was created with the capacity to solve the continuity issue for us, to define, to a training program to prep for, to solve a continuity problem. It was designed for that. God designed the Holy Spirit for that. So the Holy Spirit is not getting confused by using definition. It knows exactly the right use of time, the right use of definition, the right use of prepping, the right use of symbols, and can manifest that flawlessly and maintain it flawlessly for us. So with the Holy Spirit, we absolutely can succeed. We absolutely can finish. We absolutely can finish. Without the Holy Spirit, instead of hedonism, making the mind our guide, we're going to absolutely flounder. Thinking we can reform the mind. No. The mind is always obedient servant, always has been. Doesn't need any reformation. Cannot be reformed, cannot be changed. We have to give the mind a new idea. We have to have the Holy Spirit. Trust in the Holy Spirit to help us with our prep. And we will most certainly succeed. So, onward we go. With trust in the Holy Spirit. With this new clarification that this video's presented. I haven't seen this before. A lot of this is for me is like the first time I've seen it clearly. And the fact the Holy Spirit can manifest a world instantly is now I see how. It's just simply definition, because all of this form is just definition. It's just belief. It's just, this is how we want, change to be defined. And the Holy Spirit can say, no, let's define change this way, as change giving way to no change. Okay? As change giving way to no change. Okay, so the Holy Spirit can use definition to help us. Okay? Even though definition is a denial of reality, it can give a new purpose to this denial and say, let us practice letting go of definition. In order to practice letting go of definition, we have to have definition there for us, right? Otherwise, we couldn't practice it. So the death-free realm, which is what the Holy Spirit has shown me, is a world where nothing dies, nothing changes, everything is flawlessly present, all definitions are stable. There's no redefinition taking place. Then in that place, you can practice letting go of definition altogether. You can say, oh, here's a tree, a definition of a tree. Now let me practice letting that definition become more and more diffuse. Let me practice the edges of that definition turning into light. Let me practice that. And in such a world where there's no war, no strife, no change, no redefinition taking place, it's easy to practice letting go of definition. So the death-free realms are easy to practice there. Very easy. Here in this world, very difficult to practice. And becoming more so all the time, bureaucratically, you will get snarled in so many ways here. So The Death Ring realm, again, it is simply a great place to practice letting go of definition. So now I see it. Oh, of course, that's a piece of cake. Now I understand what it's about. Holy Spirit is defining definition for us, is giving us a definition so we can practice letting go of definition. And that's why when I was shown it, nothing dies. Everything, all definitions there are stable. They do increase a little bit in size. I saw that the trees had grown or something. Or they said the appearance of having grown. I don't know, maybe they were defined that way so we would at least be comfortable with the notion that this is a place of some process that's taken place here. But maybe Holy Spirit defined the trees with growth rings as if they had been growing, but actually the Holy Spirit defined them that way instantaneously. That is very possible. So nothing has ever changed there. But so we would feel comfortable there thinking that at least things have been growing there, you know. It might be too shocking for us if it didn't have that appearance. So it's possible it has that appearance. And it was just instantaneously defined that way. But everything is stable. It's not, there's no death, destruction, accidents, harm, disease, sickness. Everything is flawlessly stable there. And so you can completely trust in your practice. Like, I don't have to leave my practice to see what kind of changes have taken place. No, because you know if you leave your practice of letting definition become diffuse, the tree will still be exactly as it was before. It won't have changed on you. It's stable. It's not treacherous. It's not redefining itself. It's saying, this is the definition, and this is the only definition. This definition is staying stable. It's not, no redefinition is taking place. So then you can feel very, very comfortable in allowing definition to become diffuse. So you get familiar with that, and then finally you can accept, let's just drop definition altogether. So there you have it. Very strong presentation here, an advocacy of what the Holy Spirit is capable of doing for us, and why it's very effective, and why it's justifiable, etc., etc. So let's go forward with full confidence and full assurance at this point that we will not collapse. We have options. We will not collapse. We have options. Very good. That's it for this one.